Democratic State Representative Rafael Anchia of Dallas, thank you so much for joining us.
Jack, thanks for having me.
And so I wanted to ask, today at 4 o'clock, all eyes are going to be on the House to see if there's going to be a quorum. Will you be there? Will other Democrats be there? And will there, do you think, be a quorum?
Yeah, Jack, I don't think there's going to be a quorum. A couple things are happening. One, obviously, you know, we've been decamped to Washington to deal with the federal government to make sure we develop some minimum standards to protect the freedom to vote here in the state of Texas. You know, the governor for about a decade now, and before when he was attorney general, is engaged in an all-out assault and with findings of intentional discrimination against the Texas legislature as well. And so there's not a lot of confidence that that we can come up with a bipartisan voting rights bill and that Texas Republicans will protect the freedom to vote. So we went to Washington and made the case. We restarted discussions there on Capitol Hill. And then we also killed the bill during the initial session. So that was a big win. As you might understand, quorum was not made, I guess, last Saturday. Likely will not be made today. We understand that many of our colleagues on the Republican side are dealing with some breakthrough quorum, breakthrough COVID, Delta variant and exposure. So there wasn't a quorum last week. We send them our best wishes for speedy recoveries, but that seems to be the case right now. I anticipate that there will be quorum at some point in this legislative session. We're gonna keep it day by day. But what we're really doing is begging the governor. We're begging him to say, please let local school districts impose mask mandates. Let parents have the information if children in their classes test positive for COVID. Please stop defunding the Texas legislature and let's work on a bipartisan basis, because the stuff that's on the agenda right now is mainly political posturing and red meat for a Republican primary for governor and then later for a presidential run, just like his Trump wall stunt was, where he took $250 million of your money to try to finish out a small piece of a border wall. He said the rest was going to be coming via private donations that have fizzled and not materialized. So I just wish Governor Abbott would get back to basics. Let's focus on stemming the tide of COVID. Let's figure out back to school, not only for my kids who are in public school, but the millions of kids and families across the state. And then let's restore the funding to the legislative branch. You just can't defund the legislative branch because we're not doing exactly what Governor Abbott wants. That there's a separation of powers problem, and for constitutional conservatives, it should be alarming.
So you said a lot. So let's break it down a little bit. As far as the quorum, what is it going to take, do you think, for Democrats to come back and so that there is a quorum? Because you said you thought that will happen during this special session at some point.
Yeah, look, Republicans and Democrats in the House are starting to call on the governor to add or to remove his mandate that schools not require masks. That was done by executive order and not with consultation or consent of the legislative branch. We need to work on that. We need for the governor to allow cities and counties to slow the spread of COVID. That has to be on the call. He's prevented localities from doing that. That's got to change. And then finally, he needs to restore the funding of the legislative branch. He cannot be vetoing one branch of the government, separation of powers problems. So if he's willing to do those things, amend his call, because he is in full control of what he puts on or takes off a call of the legislature, we would absolutely come back, work on those things with our GOP colleagues in a bipartisan fashion, and then let's get out of Dodge. Don't try to attack trans kids as he's doing in this special session. Don't try to attack voting rights as he's doing in this special session. Don't try to attack women's reproductive health as he's doing, and even water breaks for workers, which are some of the bills that are moving through the process. So simple things like that. We know it's popular in a Republican primary, but it's just not good for Texans. So we're looking for the governor to act to remove these red meat items from the call, and let's get down to doing the business of Texas.
I spoke with Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick this morning, who said that the Democrats will be back because they're not moving out of state. And, you know, they've got their own families and lives to lead in their own districts. So is he right? And will that happen?
Well, he's not wrong about that. We all have our families and lives and the responsibilities to our own district. I mean, I imagine we'll make quorum at some point. It's just not going to happen immediately. And the lieutenant governor, unfortunately, doesn't have the ability to set the terms of this engagement. He can't determine what's on the call of the legislature. Now, what he can do is commit to a full and fair process, legislative process. And already the Texas Senate has taken steps to eliminate public testimony with adequate notice. They gave people just a couple of hours notice to come from hundreds of miles away to testify on bills. And they're just, and the lieutenant governor is committed to try to ramming through the same red meat partisan agenda on behalf of his friend, Greg Abbott.
With regards to another bill that passed a Senate committee today about lowering the quorum from a supermajority to a simple majority, where are you on that?
It's not going to pass, and I'm against it. I think the framers of the Constitution got it right, that there's an important mechanism to protect the minority, and that was Republicans for a long time, and especially rural Republicans used the rules to make sure that they were protected in redistricting or any number of other issues when they were in urban-rural disagreement. So it's not going to pass. It's going to require two-thirds of the House, two-thirds of the Senate, and then signature by the governor, and it's not going to receive those margins.
I asked him about the elections bill, and he said that there is no suppression. He's like, Democrats say it, but there is none. He's like, we're trying to expand voting hours. We're giving people a chance who vote by mail. If there's an issue, they've got 6 days to cure it, fix it. He said, you know, what's the problem? So let me have you respond to that, please.
Yeah, of course. You know, the bill text never says, this is a suppression bill, right? But what we've seen in the state of Texas during the last decade is 10 findings of intentional discrimination, including by the House and the Senate on matters of voting rights. And that's been found by bipartisan courts all over this country on 10 different occasions. That's not where they're saying, hey, we know you passed this bill, you didn't mean it, but it had a discriminatory effect. No, courts, including one court in San Antonio with two Republican appointees and one Democratic appointee, said, guys, you actually meant it. And we have emails and we have hundreds of pages worth of record where you tried to discriminate against the voters of Texas. Then there was the failed voter purge of last session where 100,000 US citizens were attempted to be purged and then turned over to the Attorney General for prosecution. That was overturned by courts. And then and the National Voter Registration Act, there have been multiple findings of Texas's non-compliance. None of the bills that I'm talking about here that have been found by courts to be intentionally discriminatory ever said, yeah, you know, we're gonna discriminate against Texas voters. So I'm not surprised that the lieutenant governor would say that. When we're talking about partisan poll workers having more rights than an independent election judge, and with the ability to see all election activity and hear all about election activity, including people who are voting, that's a problem. The secrecy of the ballot is really, really important. And the current bill that they have does not protect that. You know, in other versions of the bill, they wanted to make it harder to vote on Sunday mornings after church. Another problem, they wanted to empower partisan judges to overturn the will of the people in an election. Already, those things have been removed, even though Lieutenant Governor Patrick was hell-bent on defending those during the regular session. And then suddenly there were typos when it was time to back off those clearly intentionally discriminatory provisions. So it's not surprising that you say that. We have ample evidence in the record, not just from this session, but during the last decade, that these are the goals of these bills. Texas is already one of the toughest states to vote in, okay? Nonpartisan observers that look at the laws of Texas say It's harder to vote here than in most other states. The proof's in the pudding. We're always in the lowest quintile of states when it comes to voter participation, even though our population isn't much different than similarly situated peer states. The last thing I would mention, that government governs best when it governs least. And the only reason Republicans like Greg Abbott are trying to push these anti-voter bills is because of the big lie. A big lie that not only sparked an insurrection, but sought to, as we're finding out in recent days, engage in a coup to prevent the peaceful transition of power. And that big lie has darkened the doorstep of the Texas Capitol, because there have been no findings of fraud that would be used to bolster these tactics by Republicans. And instead, the Republican Secretary of State's office said that our election was safe, secure, and successful. So if you're seeking to infringe on a fundamental right, like the right to vote, you got to give me a reason. And don't tell me, oh, that we just didn't like either the people who voted or the way voting was done, like 24-hour voting, where that was used by voters on both sides of the aisle, 60% of whom were women. Many of them had children in the back of the car, and it was much more convenient for them to do drive-through voting. Then we had healthcare workers during the most violent pandemic in the last 100 years who used 24-hour voting. And so what we're looking at really is a bill to try to make it harder to vote, because a lot of people used these types of strategies to make it more accessible to vote, to make it safer to vote. And Republicans didn't like it. They didn't like the outcome. They see margins continuing to contract at the state level. And this is about partisan gain.
Republicans have said there's no other state in the country, there's no other county in Texas aside from Harris County that offers 24-hour voting and drive-through voting.
That was the only time during a 100-year pandemic, right? And so since we're now in a third or fourth wave or fifth wave, depending on what you how you want to describe it, we are going to be having elections during COVID. So I haven't had a Republican explain to me why it was wrong to have drive-through voting during a pandemic, why it was wrong to have 24-hour voting during a pandemic. Why is it wrong to send applications, simply applications, to people who are over 65 and who are in the highest mortality group and say, hey, if you want to vote by mail, here's your application. You could submit this back to us and we will send you a ballot. I haven't had one Republican explain, source of fraud, or two, why these are bad ideas, especially during a pandemic. So clearly too many people voted for their taste.
And let me ask you on the topic of COVID. I know one thing in speaking with parents last week, parents who have students K through six who can't get the vaccine want their school districts to provide an option where they could learn virtually, just as they did last year. Most school districts don't want to offer that because they would take a hit on funding. The lieutenant governor said that is part of this special session call where that could be added. I know this bill came up during the regular session, and the lieutenant governor blamed the Democrats for at the end of the session because this bill was up for a vote. It didn't get that vote. So I know that's a bill that you voted against last time. Have you changed your mind on that? And do you support that this time?
Well, I actually voted for making sure that local school districts did not take a hit for offering virtual learning. So I just want to be clear about that.
All right. The bill, just so that you're clear, the bill I referenced was HB 1468, which would have allowed that. Did I see that in error?
Well, you may only be looking at one piece of the puzzle. Okay. So funding for virtual school and making school districts whole was absolutely something I voted for. And I think there was broad bipartisan support for that. I didn't think that was particularly controversial at all. Schools can offer virtual learning. They're doing it right now. And what I'm encouraging the school districts that I represent, which is Carrollton Farmers Branch and Irving and Dallas, is to just ignore the governor's order on virtual school and mask mandates and not notifying kids when somebody tests positive in their class, and families when somebody tests positive in the classroom. I mean, we have to let people, our schools, districts have to let parents know when there's a lice outbreak right now. And it's incomprehensible during COVID to think that they don't have to let parents know about a COVID outbreak in their classroom. But that's what the governor said. The governor, what needs to happen, and the governor knows this, he needs to reverse his executive order, not allowing local school districts to mandate masks or require masks. He needs to change the TEA or the education agency guidance on tracing, yeah, contract tracing, and he can do all of those things. And he can also, by the way, authorize virtual school fully within his power. He's just chosen not to do that, And what I heard repeated from the lieutenant governor are talking points that are convenient, but just not accurate. He has the power to do that. He's using our kids as guinea pigs, and I fear the worst as we're now in just as bad, if not worse, position for ICU beds and hospitalizations as we were at the height of the pandemic.
Okay, and so, but just to be clear, Representative Anchia, you do support allowing school districts to provide this virtual component without taking a hit on their funding?
Oh, always have, always will. All kids are different. One of my daughters did really, really well in virtual school. She doesn't need to be in the classroom. She did way better in virtual than she did in person. And my other daughter needs to go into class. She needs the energy of the classroom. And while she did fine in virtual school, it is suboptimal for her. So we want to make sure we give parents that choice, especially under this deadly pandemic. Always have been in favor of that.
All right. Democratic State Representative Rafael Anchia from Dallas, thank you so much. We really appreciate your time as always.
Thanks, Jack.